Welcome to this 13th podcast in the series on brain development, mental health, and addiction. The series can be accessed via afmc.ca. Throughout this presentation, we will be hearing from some of the leading experts on brain development and addiction medicine from across Canada and the United States, as well as case studies and personal testimonials from professionals struggling with addiction. The podcast will also include a series of reflective questions that will link the specific learning objectives with the Medical Council of Canada objectives for the qualifying examination related to addiction. The MCC objectives are organized around physicians' roles as defined by the CanMeds and CanMeds FMU competency frameworks for undergraduate medical education. Today's topic will be an introduction to process improvement. We will talk about why business process improvement is applicable for addiction treatment programs, describe the five principles of process improvement, and identify the four key elements for improving addiction treatment processes. To begin, business process improvement is a systematic approach to help optimize an organization's underlying operational processes in order to achieve greater efficiency and improve results. This approach has been used successfully in many industries and is now being applied to healthcare. Research projects in the United States illustrate how these principles can be adopted to transform processes and improve outcomes in specific areas of addiction treatment. This is important because many addiction programs are characterized by a variety of burdensome bureaucratic and clinical processes that keep patients and staff apart and waste time and money. Worst of all, sometimes it's very difficult to change these programs if administrators and clinicians believe there is nothing they can do. Dr. David Gustafson is the founder and director of the Network for the Improvement of Addiction Treatment in Madison, Wisconsin. Here he describes the burden of learned helplessness.
I think one of the things that goes on in a lot of organizations is they have this learned helplessness. And I can understand it, and here I go, I'm going to make a comment that may be just a little bit offensive to some of you, and I apologize, but it's important to make the point. I was in Cleveland Clinic for 6 months, 5 months before my heart transplant and then 1 month after it. I had to learn how to walk, how to swallow, how to eat, how to breathe, how to talk all over again, and I can remember the day when the nurse came in and said, you know, I've got some good news for you, bad news for you. I got a lot of those. And she says, we're no longer going to wipe your butt for you. And I thought to myself, well, who is then? honestly, that simple activity, you know, that normal activity, was something that I just felt like I couldn't possibly do. And the same kind of thing exists within organizations, that they develop a learned helplessness that they honestly believe they can't change. And so one of the things that we wanted to get across to them is not only can you can change tomorrow. And so the basic idea was to get them to believe that they could change now. And the most important thing was to do it, to change something. And even if it's wrong, the key thing is to learn from the experience. And so anything worth doing was worth doing well.
Recently, the healthcare industry has started looking to business process improvement principles in order to improve access and retention to care. 2 decades of research at the Network for the Improvement of Addiction Treatment in the U.S. has identified 5 key principles underlying successful process improvement efforts. The first is that change needs to be closely linked to the leadership's agenda. Rather than trying to obtain buy-in from leadership to your ideas, try to align your plans to the goals of the organization. In other words, do what helps the CEO sleep better at night. A second principle is that the change leader should be an influential and respected member of the organization, rather than a new employee or any employee who has the time to do the job. An employee who is respected, has a reputation of getting things done, and is already familiar with the processes of your organization is the perfect choice. The third and perhaps most important point is that those involved with the change movement should personally experience what the customers of the organization's services and/or products experience. This personal experience is critical in order to understand both the customers and providers' difficulties in the system. Dr. Gustafson explains.
The third thing, and by the way, by far the most important thing, was to personally experience what the customers of your organization experience. And this in Japan is called the walk of shame. I'm sure they use a Japanese term for it, but that's the interpretation of it. To personally experience what the customers go through. So for every one of the 2,500 organizations that are part of Niatex now, they have to, as a starting point, personally experience what it's like to be a customer. So they have to do sort of what I did. They have to do a walkthrough. And if it takes 30 minutes to fill out a form, they take 30 minutes to fill out a form. If they can't go the next step without waiting 6 weeks, they have to wait 6 weeks and so on like that. But the key element in all of this is you got to understand your customers. We need to understand what they're going through. We can't possibly improve things. At the same time, though, when we go through the walkthrough, it's really important to ask the staff, what can we do to make things better for our customers, and what things can we do to make things better for you? And as a result, what you get there is real support from them, because the ultimate objective is to make things better for both.
The fourth principle of process improvement is that organizations should seek and use ideas from external sources. For example, look to lessons learned from other industries that currently excel at what you're trying to accomplish, and work with other organizations that want to make similar kinds of improvements. Dr. Gustafson details how this can lead to healthy competition, as well as partnerships and collaboration.
The best ideas for improvement come not from just within inside the organization, but from outside of it, from other people in your own field, but also even going further than that, other organizations in other industries. You know, for instance, if we were trying to put together a communication system for an organization, we might say to ourselves, what other industries really worry about communication ideas? And you might conclude from that, well, certainly one is radio and television. Another is information technology, social networking, and that kind of stuff. And then you might sit back and say, well, does any organization really stand out in the area of communication? You might say Apple. And then the final question is to ask, what do they do step by step, but what is it that distinguishes them from competitors? And as it turns out, I did a Google search, and about that question, what makes Apple stand out? And I got 9,000 hits. And so I read a couple of the articles, and they gave me great insights into what makes Apple stand out. For instance, one of the things they said is that Apple's, it isn't that they're first to the market or that they're the cheapest or that kind of stuff, but in communication, one of the things is that they make sure to reward the people whose resources they're using. And so, for instance, in their iTunes, they were the first organization to go back and say, we're going to really stress who the artist is, we're going to make sure that we pay them for the services that we're getting and things like that. So, you know, you can very quickly and easily get ideas for how to improve by reaching out and asking, you know, what other industries are trying to do the same thing we're trying to do? What's the best organization in the field, the one that really stands out? What makes them so good? What can we learn from that will help us?
The fifth and final principle of process improvement is to use rapid cycle testing of the proposed change in order to improve the process over a short period of time. This is critical because when implementing change, the most important element is to keep the change effort simple and short term. So you should adopt very few and very specific aims for what needs to be accomplished. Use only one or two simple outcome measures to assess whether the change is working. These measures should be driven by the change effort rather than using existing outcome measures that are perhaps not appropriate. Finally, be prepared to fail, particularly at the start. Rapid cycle testing is a learning process, and each failure of the chain represents valuable information that can be used in the next cycle of testing. This will allow you to make quick adjustments during the change process. The entire change effort should take no more than 3 weeks from start to finish. Dr. Gustafson summarizes rapid cycle testing.
And then the final thing that it turns out to be important is rapid cycle testing. And in this particular area, I'll use an example. When we first started out our initiative, we had money from the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation that people could compete for, agencies could compete for. And so we got, 300 applications from agencies and whittled those down to 40 organizations. And we said, okay, we need to have a full proposal from you saying what you'll do. Oh, and by the way, you need to have it in within 3 weeks. Oh, and by the way, as part of the proposal, we want you to pick something, change it, evaluate it, and improve it, and evaluate it again. And all that has to be done in 3 weeks. And so we got the 40 applications back. And some amazing things came out of that. But one of them was Acadia Hospital up in Maine, Bangor, Maine, decided that waiting time was way too long for their intensive outpatient program. And they thought about it, got ideas, talked to people, looked around and said, you know, what would happen if we just stopped making appointments and just said, come on in, when you're ready, we'll be there and we'll get you into treatment that day if you come in the morning. And so they tried it. And the first day, what they did was they said, well, let's try it with two patients and one counselor. And so the first two phone calls that came, they said, why don't you come in this morning? Actually, it was three phone calls. I take it back. It was three people. And two of them did. And one person said, I can't. I got to work. And so that evening, they sat back down and they said, well, it worked pretty good. I mean, these two people came in. We found we could get them into treatment. Didn't seem to upset the operation of the organization at all. But there was this one person who had to work. And so they changed the thing. And they gave the option of, well, can you come in this morning? And if not, they said, well, when can you come in? Okay, well, we'll take you then. No appointment. Just come in then. We'll be looking forward to seeing you. And then they said, well, now let's try this with two counselors and with five callers. And so they did that, and they tried it out, and they learned some things. Didn't work perfectly, but they were getting closer. And within a period of that three-week period, they had changed their admission process. They had eliminated appointments. And over the next year, the number of admissions per month grew from 16 to 106. They were spending, instead of being a draw of $200,000 on the organization, overall organization each year, they were making $1 million for the organization. That one little change, done very quickly, and realizing that it didn't work and improving it, and realizing that didn't work and improving it again, made that kind of an impact. And that isn't just one, I mean, that's one example of many cases where the idea of rapid cycle improvement, they do it fast, what can you do Monday morning? Cycle, try it out, we know it won't work right, try it out, fix it, try it again. Fix it, try it again, was the fundamental approach to this.
The Network for the Improvement of Addiction Treatment has identified four key areas in which addiction treatment agencies could greatly improve their business processes. 1, reduce the delay between first contact and obtaining treatment. 2, reduce no-shows. 3, increase admissions. And 4, increase continuity rates. Their research shows that changing from scheduled appointments to walk-in appointments is a highly effective change an organization can make to reduce no-shows, increase admissions, and reduce the delay in obtaining treatment. Organizations have also successfully increased their continuity rates by enrolling patients in outpatient programs while they are still in residential treatment and scheduling joint sessions between residential and outpatient programs. Dr. Gustafson explains.
First thing was that the aim had to be really clear. You know, it's when we had decided there was only two things we were interested in: improve the time it takes to get into treatment, and keep patients in treatment longer. That was it. Nothing else. It reduced the time to treatment, keep patients in treatment longer. That's it. Those two things. Nothing else. And then we said, okay. And more than that, we hate lots of measures. We don't want to measure this and measure that. Let's take for each one of these things, there's only two measures you're allowed to collect, no more. And they have to be simple, and they ought to be able to be collected on the back of an envelope. And so what we found was that as far as getting access, getting patients into treatment sooner, the only thing we were going to measure was how long did it take from the time when the patient first called to when they got into treatment. That's the one measure we were going to collect, nothing else. And then the second measure we were going to do was, do they actually show up for the treatment? And so we collected one thing there. Did they show up or not? Third thing was we wanted to increase the number of admissions. So over this period of time, how many patients were we treating when we started? How many did we treat when we ended? And then finally, increase the continuation rates. How many patients actually made it through the first four treatments? Nothing else. No surveys, no detailed measures, and for heaven's sakes, not using existing databases. Collect all the data precisely on what you want for that activity, collect it on the back of an envelope, do it with very few patients, and use that as your measure of improvement.
In closing, it's important to note that individuals and organizations are often resistant to change or feel that the process will be too time-consuming, difficult, or costly. In fact, if planned properly, change can be rapid, adaptive, and efficient. Dr. Gustafson shares his summary of effective process improvement.
Just change something, you know. The key thing is to get rid of the learned helplessness. Just pick anything to change, because there's so many opportunities for improvement that you can tackle almost anything, and you know it, if you tackle it right, it's going to make a difference. And do it fast. You know, if you figure, skipping the rapid cycle for a second, I'm not sure I see any reason for a quality improvement project to last longer than 3 weeks. From start to finish. The thing that drives me nuts is, okay, we're going to meet with our quality improvement team once a week. Well, you know, half the time you spend is trying to figure out what we said we were doing a week ago, right? And we don't get anything done. So if you're really interested in making a change, then allocate the time necessary so you can do it in rapid fashion. Because if you take a long time, if it takes 6 months, you may have had leadership support at the beginning. They'll be off on another kind of activity long before the 6 months is up. Give yourself 3 weeks to make the thing, to finish it, start to finish. Rapid cycles. It's going to work wrong the first time you try it, but you're going to learn from it. Try it in a very small way. Learn from the experience. Make a modification. And then I guess I'd finally end up with this. The point that I tried to stress with our colleagues in this industry is that change is simple. You know, people say change is hard. Change isn't hard. Change is easy. The tough thing is getting that change to be sustained. You know that. I mean, probably more than any other industry in the country, you know that sustainability is the issue. It's not the change. And so working on sustainability is a key element.
So here is a summary of the key points in this podcast. Business process improvement provides principles that can be applied to enhance addiction treatment programs. The five principles of process improvement are: link change to the leadership agenda, pick a respected and experienced change leader, embrace ideas from outside the organization, participate in the patient experience, and employ rapid cycle testing. The four key elements for improving addiction treatment processes are: reduce the delay from first contact to treatment, reduce no-shows, increase admissions, and increase continuity rates. If planned and executed properly, process change can be rapid, adaptive, and efficient. So as we reach the end of this podcast, here are some reflective questions on the origins of addiction. They are based on the CanMed's competencies and address how you will deal with addiction in your practice. 1. First, in your role as a medical student or practicing physician, how will you integrate and apply this new knowledge on the principles of business process improvement? 2. How can you participate in the patient experience in your program or practice? 3. What steps can you take to implement the four elements for improving business processes in your program or practice? We hope that you've enjoyed this podcast on process improvement. We welcome your comments in the feedback section at the bottom of this webpage, and we invite you to continue exploring this series as we examine in more detail the core concepts of early childhood development, as well as the types, causes, and treatment of addiction. This podcast series is based on lectures from the Alberta Family Wellness Initiative, a knowledge mobilization initiative designed to translate scientific research into policy and practice. The podcasts were developed by the Association of Faculties of Medicine of Canada with guidance from a project advisory committee and produced by Hugh Kellum and Colin McDonald at the University of Ottawa. Narration was done by Hugh Kellum. This project was sponsored by the Norlin Foundation. The complete podcast series can be accessed via afmc.ca.